Welcome everyone, bienvenue tout le monde ce soir. We're going to start in just a couple of minutes, donc on va commencer dans quelques minutes. J'ai juste quelques petites annonces. Alors, il y a deux issues de secours, il y a deux entrées sorties de la salle. L'entrée principale et une autre sortie ici à votre gauche. So there are two main entry and exit points, the main entry that you came in, and there's another one over to this side to your left. If you're looking for the washrooms, please just go outside the main entry points and turn right. Donc, si vous cherchez les toilettes, vous sortez par l'entrée principale et vous virez à droite. So any other comments or questions, feel free to ask anybody of us who has a name tag, and we will be starting in just a couple of minutes. Donc, on va commencer dans quelques minutes. Merci. Thank you.
Bonsoir, mesdames et messieurs. Bienvenue. Hello, everyone. Kwe Kakina. I'd like to welcome you all here to the Capital Urbanism Lab. We have some members of the board of directors of the NCC here tonight. We have Denis Vaillancourt. Denis, can you put your hand up so people can see you? Good, yeah. And Tanya Gracie. Good. And we also have Kay Stanley, who can't resist coming out, who was on our board up until very recently. Thank you for coming, Kay. So distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Mark Christmensen. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of the National Capital Commission. It's a real pleasure to welcome you here tonight to kick off the fifth season of programming of the Capital Urbanism Lab. And I'll take this opportunity to welcome everyone who's watching on the live stream, which is a growing audience for us. So thank you for participating. I would also like to begin my remarks today by recognizing that we are here today on the traditional territory of the Algonquin people. Permettez-moi aussi de souligner que nous sommes en territoire traditionnel de la Première Nation Algonquine. I would also like to offer words of support and concern on behalf of the NCC to those affected by the tornadoes that struck the region on Friday. We've discussed the resilience of cities in this room at the Urbanism Lab. I think it's a subject, Stan, that will have to come back. The resilience of cities is a growing issue. I am really astounded in a way that here we are starting a fifth season, that it's been 4 years since the first Urbanism Lab. That was a session on design excellence hosted in partnership with the Royal Architectural Institute of Canada. When we launched the lab in 2014, our hopes were that it was a pop-up experiment, and we hoped that we could identify challenges in urbanism and public science and advance the NCC's role as a creative partner. And I think it has served that purpose. It's also a project that is driven by the staff, our professional staff. Stan Leinwand coordinates the content, but there are many people also behind the scenes who work on it. So congratulations, Stan and Luke and Mamadou and everyone. And Stan, you might want to name a few more people on the committee and so forth when you speak. Part of the inspiration of this is really design thinking, and I do believe in design thinking as a way of solving thorny issues in not just in design but in society as a whole. Dr. Ed Catmull, the president of Pixar, has an idea sharing group that he calls the Brain Trust, and he says put smart, passionate people in a room together, charge them with identifying and solving problems, and encourage them to be candid. Well, that's what we do. We have a lot of candor here, and I think the other people that have made this a success are you, because you come out and we pretty much have a full house every time, and we have great discussions, so thank you very much. Je crois que nous avons fait ces quatre années, dernières années, nous avons organisé 50 activités au labo auxquelles ont participé près de 17 500 personnes. Nous avons collaboré avec un grand nombre de partenaires issus de différents milieux, universités, groupes de réflexion, gouvernements, ambassades, organismes de la conservation et du patrimoine et les grands publics. We've heard many presentations, big ideas, from conserving modern heritage to driverless vehicles, how to build sustainable and resilient communities, and what it means to be a winter capital. Some of these ideas find their way, and some of the things you'll say, I hope, tonight will find their way into plans and projects. I could mention the Capital Illumination Plan, which we discussed here, that's now a reality. I could mention the plan for Canada's capital. Many elements of that were discussed here. So this is the river plans. For those of you who follow our board meetings, you'll know that the board was very, very appreciative of the Ottawa River South Shore Linear Park plan, which was really conceived in this room with a series of design charrettes. So this year we have an extraordinary lineup of events. I'm not going to go through them all. You can see them on the website. But can neurology explain why we react the way we do to our built environment? How does biophilic design make us healthier and happier? How can big data make urban governance more effective? So these are three of the topics, but there are many more. Have a look at the website. And we'll close the season in June with our annual Urbanism Lab on National Indigenous Peoples Day, or the night before, and we'll be exploring probably in this case archaeology and all the work our archaeology department has been doing, which I think people will be interested in. This summer, the NCC partnered with the City of Ottawa and Public Services and Procurement Canada to begin developing a plan to rejuvenate Spark Street. So tonight's session, Designing a Pedestrian Paradise, is actually very timely for us. We're in the middle of thinking of that with our partners, and I see we have some people here from the city. Thank you for coming. Des rues et des quartiers animés et invitants pour les piétons sont essentiels à la création d'une capitale dynamique et branchée. Énoncé qui, vous en souviendrez, est l'un des trois piliers du nouveau plan de la capitale du Canada. So I know you're looking forward to get started, so I'm going to introduce our panel. With us tonight is Cynthia Nikitin, Senior Vice President with the Project for Public Spaces in New York. As a speaker, writer, and urban planner, she advocates for placemaking as a way to strengthen community connections and make communities safer, among other economic, social, and environmental benefits. She has an expertise in many areas of relevance to our capital, including government campuses, libraries, cultural institutions, public art, and spaces related to public transit. She shares her expertise with communities around the globe, including Nairobi, Johannesburg, Penang, and Malaysia. She's also the Project for Public Spaces representative on the UN Habitat's Global Network for Safer Cities. So thank you so much for coming. And I'm going to, no, wait.
Wait, we're not done yet.
Clap. Okay, I like that. We'll clap. But I'll do all the introductions so we don't take any more time. René Daou, un partenaire de la firme Daou Lestage de Montréal, est architecte, urbaniste, éducateur et conférencier. Elle supervise le plan directeur pour le vieux port de Montréal et joue un rôle de premier plan en matière d'excellence en design pour l'Eglinton Crosstown, un système de transport léger sur rail, le plus important projet d'expansion de transport en commun de l'histoire de Toronto et le plus important projet de partenariat public-privé au Canada. Some of René's past work includes the campus plan for the Université de Québec à Trois-Rivières, at Drummondville, housing at the Athletes Village for the Toronto 2015 Pan American Games, and the rehabilitation of Montreal's theater district. She is a member of the L'Ordre des Urbanistes de Québec and a fellow of the Royal Architectural Institute of Canada. Réal Lestage est un urbaniste et membre fondateur de Daou Lestage, où il défend l'intégrité des disciplines de conception. Son volumineux curriculum vitae fait état de ses rôles de leader dans des projets marquants, dont ceci, la promenade de Samuel de Champlain. Nous avons étudié ça ici avec le CCNQ. Qui était ici, un projet de réaménagement du secteur riverain de Québec qui a marqué le 400e anniversaire de la ville, où il est présentement responsable de la phase 3. Le réaménagement de quartier de la colline parlementaire de Québec, la revitalisation de la promenade Gérard-Côté à Saint-Hyacinthe. Réal is a member of the City of Montreal's Architectural and Urban Planning Committee, and his expertise in urban renewal projects make him a much-sought lecturer and competition jurist. In 2016, Réal and René were awarded the Prix Ernest Cormier, which is the Governor of Quebec's highest distinction in architecture and design. Ron Redmond is Executive Director of the Church Street Marketplace District in Burlington, Vermont. Thank you for coming up, Ron. A pedestrian mall set amid a historic neighborhood that has been recognized by the American Planning Association as one of the great public spaces in America. He's worked with established and emerging downtowns and for 4 years served on the board of the International Downtown Association. That's an organization that champions the development of healthy and vibrant neighborhoods. He's currently a member of the association's Professional Development Committee. Je sais que les gens ici présents qui se soucient de l'avenir de la rue Sparks seront très intéressés par le point de vue de Ron et de nos autres invités de ce soir. So maybe now we could give a welcome for all our guests. Thank you for coming. Mm-hmm. It's a great lineup, and I'll turn it over to Stan. Okay, Madame Nikita.
Directly to me.
Yeah, directly
okay,
to you.
To
did I take anything of yours?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank there. You.
Okay.
Perfect. Great. Can everyone see? Are the lights okay? The screens are okay. Okay, good. Just checking. Great. Oh, good. It's in French. Okay. Bonsoir. Hello, hello. Welcome. Thank you for coming out tonight for this urbanism panel. I was just talking to Patrick, thinking about how many cities in the United States would have a turnout like this for this topic. And I can think of like 5 cities, you know, but not very many. And so it's really a tribute to you all as thinkers. And you live in the city, so you are urbanists and you are placemakers. And you are the folks that these projects are for. You are the client, the NCC, the City of Ottawa. This is, you are ultimately the folks that they're doing their work for. So we try to make sure that you all have a voice in what happens and empower communities to shape the built environment. So that is what I will be speaking about this evening. Okay. So this is, how many of you remember as kids playing on the street in front of your house? Just like, oh my God, like that's a lot. That's more than half. Okay, how many of you let your kids or grandkids or nieces and nephews play on the street in front of their house? Okay, still significant. Very good, very good. So traditionally, historically, that's what streets were for. Obviously, before they were overrun by automobiles, but William White has a saying, the street is the river of life. You know, it flows through the center of our cities. And it actually accounts for more public space than anything else. 80% of the public space in any city or town are streets and roads. Okay, more than parks, more than waterfronts, more than plazas, streets and roads. Whoever controls the streets and roads has all the toys and they win. So for many, many decades, too many decades, transportation engineers and others, I don't want to call anyone out, have been designing our cities de facto because they've been giving streets and transportation and cars and trucks priority over pedestrians. And that is changing, so happy to say. So the idea was like overkill. To get rid of the weeds in your garden, you kill all the flowers, and to get rid of all the congestion, you get rid of all the destinations and the places. And you know, people say there's not enough parking in a city. No one goes somewhere because it has great parking. You just don't, let's go to Elmira, New York. There's nothing to do but wow, fabulous parking. Great, just so many spaces, you can just move your car around all day. No, we go to places where there is no parking, where we have to walk 4 blocks or pay to park our car, and we can't wait to go there. So thinking about designing streets and designing downtowns for cars instead of for people is kind of antithetical to good urbanism and good cities. And as a result, we have been building transportation through communities and bulldozing communities and widening roads, et cetera. But there is a way to build communities through thoughtful, well-designed, well-balanced transportation projects. So, streets, after all, are for people. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what makes a street successful, qualities of great streets. You will think about this in your own high street or Spark Street Mall or places where you like to go and visit. But these are sort of intuitive things, intangible. And what we do at Project for Public Spaces is make the intangible tangible, is we work with folks like you to focus your observation so that you actually can quantify things that are working and make identify problems, because that's what designers and architects need. It's like, I don't feel safe here is an important statement, but I don't know if that means because there's a perception of crime because there's no one on the street and there's no lighting and there's blank walls, or I don't feel safe here because I'm on a 1 meter sidewalk and there's 80,000 cars a day driving past me. So we try to get sort of these important emotional sense of place ideas and turn them into more sort of metrics and elements that then can be turned into design so that design can be made. So it's sort of a bridge. So I just kind of facilitate these conversations between folks. But so this is sort of looking at, why do you like the street? Well, it has these qualities: attractions and destinations. So we were walking down the Sparks Street Mall, and there's some really wonderful pockets of really interesting stuff. And then there's a lot of very big buildings with that are very slippery, that have blank facades or no ground floor retail, or are designed in such a way that they're much more interesting at the top than at the bottom. So there's a real mixture. So, well, what do? Well, you focus on the nodes. When you have a corridor or a five-block mall, you find these little funny, quirky, wonderful things. Like there's a Canadian arts craft store next to a coffee shop, and there's some outdoor seating. Okay, that could be a node. So you kind of look at, where are these sort of little, where are people going? Where are the destinations? And you build on that. So the idea is not to start with a blank slate and not to start with the most difficult or problematic areas, but to look for signs of intelligent life and figure out how to make them better, and then how to link them. So, I mean, attractions can be artwork, of course, seating, looking at people doing other things. People attract people, attract people. Doesn't have to be big and expensive, but there needs to be a reason for you to continue on your journey. There has to be things that kind of catch your eye. So when we're designing or placemaking on streets, we're looking at, where are these nodes? What is the interesting things? How do we make them more visible? And then how do we connect them? This idea of authenticity, I cannot overemphasize, and Ron is going to talk a little bit about this later, but people come to places because they want to know what makes it tick. And showcasing local assets is the way to create a sense of place. So there's a wonderful exhibit outside on the mall, and it's like art. It's just like culture from around the world, and it's like these really interesting easel installations, and it's about Denmark and Belgium and all the things that make these other cities great. Where's the one on Ottawa? Like, where do I see that? I have to go into a building or into a museum. So it's sort of showcasing things in your face, in the public space. Don't make people hunt for it. Really just get out there. And when you have a place that is lively and full of people, then sort of you get this really wonderful, unexpected things happen. And we think that public spaces, whether it's a plaza or a park or a waterfront or a library, are really a canvas or a stage set for things to happen. That you're creating this venue for people to come and do what they want to do, or have a program. When you go outside and you eat your lunch and you check your phone, and you sit on a bench and you talk to your friend, you are self-programming. You brought your own toys and your own props, and you've created this, you've found a space where you can have lunch and talk to your friend. That's really important. That's kind of what we're talking about, but that's a really small scale, but you can sort of make it exponentially bigger. The edges are really important, and that's a challenge with our site out here. So I don't know if we're ever going to be able to fix that, but with design features, with banners, with coverings, with bringing out sandwich boards or signage, moving sort of the edges out to the middle, you can kind of create that sense of enclosure and connecting the inner to the outer, because that's really what makes a great square, for example, is the edges supporting what's happening in the middle. I have colleagues that program a lot of public markets, farmers markets. We have a very big program, and we'll go to a plaza, and they want a farmer's market, and they spread all the vending booths out. It doesn't work. We have to cram it all together. You basically create this really narrow aisle, and people are bumping into each other. The rest of the plaza can be completely empty, but it's that sense of enclosure and closeness that actually adds vibrancy and spark to a place. Amenities are vitally important. I know there's some new furniture out there. Movable seating, movable seating, movable seating, movable seating, movable seating. Not expensive. IKEA has it. Fairmob has it. It's colors. You can get it kid size, adult size. People like to be able to move furniture around. And it's nice if there's someone who can kind of stack them up at the end of the day. But really giving people a variety of seating options. They've been doing it all over New York City. And the world didn't end. And they're not ending up in the river, and no one is clubbing anyone to death with a Fairmob chair. It's fine. But you put the seating in front of the business where it makes sense. You don't need movable seating in front of a bank because it's just not. But in front of an ice cream parlor, in front of a cafe, even in front of a shoe repair place, because people go in or they get their keys duplicated. So thinking about where the seating goes is very important when you do that. And I realize there really isn't anything on the malls like for daily needs. There's no hardware store. There's no supermarket. So as more residential comes downtown, I think you're going to see that happen. They finally got like a grocery store in downtown Los Angeles, and there's like 30,000 residential units. So retail follows residential. It never leads. But you will see that. So they like big spaces, big, vacant, empty spaces, supermarket, Trader Joe's. It'll be great. Don't worry. And then, of course, the fun stuff. Ron will talk about this too. Intrigue, uncertainty, humor, art, pop-up. If there's vacant storefronts, opportunity for pop-up art. You've seen this in other places. It can happen here. Just sort of this sense of intrigue. I was in Portland, Maine, and it was quite chilly. It was November, and they were doing an art walk. And in the ground floor of the library, there was a ballet performance going on. And there were ballet dancers, and the speakers were facing the street. And we were outside shivering, watching a ballet in the ground floor of a library at 7 o'clock at night when the library is closed. So that was wonderful. That was really unexpected. And they do that a lot. So, you know, there's spaces where art and culture and things can happen at unusual times of the day and even off season. Management is very important. It is maintenance, but it's really, you know, stewards, ambassadors, people that really know what's going on the street that are out there on a regular, ongoing basis, looking at how to make it better, because you're never really finished. If you're not going to manage it, don't build it. It's sort of like you build a house, and then you never touch it, right? No, you have to fix the roof, you have to get a new dishwasher, you have to repair the furnace, you know, and we think we can build stuff in the public realm and just walk away. Everything needs maintenance. You've got a car, you got to get the oil changed. So it's the same thing with public space, and you need to create a team of folks that are going to do it. Sometimes it's ambassadors, sometimes it's volunteers, the friends of group. So you signed in, haha, you're all on, no. But this is why we have these meetings, because you are obviously care about this place, so you would be folks that would want to help make it better. So just letting you know. Flexibility, you know, again, with the movable seating, and just things can look different during the day and the night and weekends. Seasonal strategies, you know, really embrace the winter and think about programming for that time of year. There's first night celebrations everywhere. There's things that can happen, you know. Calgary had that wonderful light bulb project in the middle of their Olympics Plaza. It was just fabulous artwork, and all these people got together, and you just, like, turn the light bulbs on and off on pull chain, really simple. It was like people were there, like, till 11 o'clock at night in February, just, like, turning lights on and off. Just had the best time. Okay. Well, that's Calgary. Anyway. So then thinking, and this is really, you know, obviously you've had tornadoes. Everywhere else they're having floods, and stormwater is an issue, and managing flows and managing sewage overflows and combined sewer, stormwater, rain gardens and swales, and looking at the landscaping as a way of actually helping to deal with an environmental challenge. Use that water, slow it down as it trickles into the system, and then create wonderful plantings as well as, you know, aesthetic things that attract pollinators and birds and bees and butterflies, and managing runoff. So there's a technical piece to it. This is a project in Philadelphia, and the folks that are actually working on this, it's the water department. It's not the urban planners. It's not the architects. It's the water department that's working on creating these greener streets. To, again, 100-year-old infrastructure or more as a way of preventing flooding. And by the way, you build a wonderful habitat at the same time. Oh, missing a picture there on one of them. That's an important picture. I hit that one. What if I hit this again? Nope. All right, the upper left is the most important image that's missing. You have it over there. Okay, it's the community is the expert. Is the most important thing. So you are the community, you are the experts. I come from New York. This is my second time here. There's no way I'm going to tell you what you should do. And if I try to do that, you should kick me out immediately, because I'm here to find out what you know, what your ideas are, and build on your experience, get all the answers from you, and then figure out how to make that real, how to make that into a plan or a design. So it all starts with you. So coming to these events, showing up at them, focus groups, is very, very, very important. Okay, a place, not just a design. Place is sort of a spiritual thing as well as a design is a part of it. But you need these amenities and these activities as well. And you need partners, and you need unlikely partners like the water department to redesign the streets in Philadelphia. You can't do it alone. We need to look at working with city agencies across silos and partner with civic institutions, cultural institutions. I always go first to the librarians and the artists, because librarians deal with people all the time, and artists are very creative, and both of those groups are used to doing way too much with no resources. So they get very, very creative. So librarians and artists, they always want to do something, they always want to create, they always have books they want to read and share, and they have art projects they want to do, and they don't have any space. So they're very good to kind of get the conversation going. This is our process, where we start with identifying, defining the place, and looking at who's using it, who cares about it, who are the stakeholders, who are the property owners, who's here on a regular basis. And then before we do anything, we evaluate what's working about it, what's not working about it. What would attract people to be here? And if we wanted them to come, what else, what other design or physical features would we need to make it comfortable for them? So we evaluate it, figure out what's going on, come up with a vision, collective vision with the community, and then we test things out. And I know you were doing that over the summer, that there was some testing. But when you're testing, you're really analyzing, and you're actually surveying people, saying, how do you like this little free library? How many times do you come down to this place? Our colleagues in Indianapolis do wonderful surveys, and they say, you know, how many of you have talked to a new person, like had a conversation with a stranger? Like, that's one of the metrics of how successful a place is, that people feel comfortable talking to people who don't look like them or who they don't know. So those are, these kinds of experiments can kind of get people talking, and then you go back and you decide what you want to make permanent, but you're always evaluating it. You're always trying to make it better. Okay, so this is kind of that spectrum of change where you have the demonstration, it's kind of painted, and it's kind of rough, and it's out there, and you don't want to leave it like looking like that for very long. And there's a pilot project, which again, it's temporary, but can be 3 to 6 months. Then there's the interim design, and then there's the permanent installation. And this could take over a period of a couple of years, but what happens is that folks that say, this will never work. If you close Broadway to traffic in New York City, the world will implode, and we will all die, and it will be horrible. And we just painted it and put out lawn furniture, and lo and behold, everyone used 7th Avenue, and it all worked out. And then they made it more permanent, and it's really overused, and it needs another design. There's refreshing that happens. When you create or renovate or improve a public space, it needs to be refreshed after a while, which is what I think Spark Street is doing. Good. Okay. Okay. Where am I? Okay. Indianapolis Cultural Trail, the first urban bikeway in the United States. And when they were designing this, the goal was to connect all the cultural institutions in Indianapolis to build support for their cultural sector, because they have fabulous cultural institutions and not enough audience. So the idea was they're going to take out a lane of traffic and basically have a bike trail in town that goes to each and every one of these places. So this is kind of the rendering of how it would look, taking out, you know, over-designed for traffic. Indianapolis does not have that many people. It's getting more. A lot of our cities in the U.S. are losing population. And then celebrating and creating these nodes around these cultural facilities, and then they spread outward, and now it's about 8 miles long. It's generated hundreds of millions of dollars in revenue. People come from the suburbs, from everywhere, to come and ride their bike and walk. It's got wonderful landscaping. It's all bioswales. It's all about sort of this natural urban setting, and it's really a lot of fun. So there's ways of changing the culture. So you know, stop thinking about how do we get more cars in, or even, oh, how do we stripe in a bike lane? You have to think much more comprehensively based on the context. So I know that you all have adopted sort of this complete street paradigm, and this is not the only definition of it, but the goal is it has appropriate speeds, because you can design a road for the speed of the vehicles that you want it to travel, comfortable for all users, and fits into the context. And it usually has sidewalks and crosswalks and medians and parking. It doesn't have to have all of these things, but it makes it, again, clustering all of these wonderful elements together. People will take more public transportation, or they'll ride their bike because it feels safer. Local businesses get more foot traffic so they can grow. It's good for the environment, improves safety, and eyes on the street. So these are just two recent examples. This is Exhibition Road. I misspoke. It's not Kensington High Street. It's Exhibition Road in London. London's most important cultural attractions, the Natural History Museum, the Science Museum, the Royal Albert Hall, and the Imperial College of London. 11 million people visit it each year. Oh my God, and that was it. And it was all these cars and no sidewalks. The shared space concept came in 2009. It's 24 meters wide. They wanted to make it safer. And it opened in 2012. So they removed the curb, they minimized signs, they created visual tactile lines to designate pedestrian-only areas. They lowered the speed, they installed new lighting, and it cost $46 million. Okay. But this was a major cultural center. Again, you're designing a place for cars when it's really full of cultural institutions. My issue is that these buildings need to turn themselves inside out. You still don't know that you've got the Royal Albert Hall, the Imperial College, the Science Museum, and the History Museum, because they're all in, like, all the art is in art jail inside the buildings. And so I would like to see more permeable connections between the inside and the outside. Here's another sort of how it works. This is, like, much more technical sort of issue. So this is about, they had all these Chinese granite, a million bricks of Chinese granite. I'm like, great, but what is there to do there? So there's kind of this idea of doing it this way or this way. So this will blow your mind, because it blew my mind. Moscow. Who's heard of My Streets Moscow? Who has been to Moscow? Is it not the butt ugliest city you've ever been to in your life? Do you feel like your life, like days, last five times as long? Yeah, my last name is Nikitin. My husband, Evgeny Mikhailovich, who I adore, is from Moscow. So I've been there more than any other international city, and I hate it. However, in 2014, they got a new mayor, Sergei Sobyanin, and he decided to undertake this My Streets program. They were targeting 4,000 streets in central Moscow. They've only done about 300. It's costing them about $3.5 billion, which is not that much. But the idea was that the mayor comes in and goes, we want to compete with London and Paris and New York for tourists and residents. And so they decided that creating a high-quality urban environment with people in mind will make the city more livable. You could have just knocked me over with a feather when I heard this. My friends at the Strelka Urban Consultancy came up with these typologies and with design standards, and they, they're doing amazing things. They hired international design teams, which I have a problem with, because I like capacitating local designers and planners and going to a place and finding out who's amazing and build the local capacity. In Russia, they like West 8 and Martha Schwartz, and there's nothing wrong with those firms, but they don't, they don't have a Russian mother-in-law. They don't really know what they're doing, I think, in that regard. So this is little Dmitrovka Street, and I don't even have to explain to you the before is on the left, which those of us who've been to Moscow, is every single street in Moscow. It's just messy, and there's overhead wires, and there's garbage, and there's people just parking on the sidewalks, and awful. And then the redesign on the right, they have a clear sky program where they are undergrounding wires and they're getting rid of illegal advertising, and they're basically burying all their infrastructure. That costs a lot of money, but I guess they're doing it. So this is ongoing. This is quite recent. Amazing. I look at this and I go, I still can't believe it. Okay. Triumphalnaya Square, again, just very historic place. It had a circus at one point and a marketplace, and then it was just like an asphalt-covered sea of parking. And now if you can see in the lower right there, they have the swings that were very popular in Montreal. So they have swings, cafes, and an information center for tourists. And my friends from Moscow who moved to New York, like, go back home and go to these places, and also can't believe it. And then there's just other little streets that are just been pedestrianized and better lighting. They don't look as vibrant. I mean, the messy, so there's this line between messy and congested and diesel fuel and getting hit by cars and sterile. And I, you know, and so there's that really, because that grit, you still kind of need that kind of gritty element. So now we can all go to Moscow. It's okay. We go there. It's a much better environment. So just to close, streets are for everything and everyone. Streets are a public stage where the city, the life of a city unfolds. And this is how you can find out more about PPS. Thank you for your time and attention. Sure.
Il faut attendre un peu. On attend les images. It's not a good one. C'est pas la bonne. C'est Burlington. It's a nice project also, but ça compte pas dans notre 20 minutes, ça? Non, c'est bon. Okay. C'est bon. Parfait. Alors, bonsoir. D'abord, peut-être un mot sur Daou Lestage. On est une firme multidisciplinaire qui œuvre dans le milieu de l'aménagement. On a une pratique qui se décline de l'urbain à l'objet. En fait, c'est la particularité de l'équipe chez nous. On travaille les projets à partir de la grande vision d'ensemble jusque dans ses moindres détails. Il y a donc là l'expertise en design urbain, en paysage, en architecture intérieure, en design industriel et même en design graphique. Donc, à l'intérieur de la même boîte, on partage la philosophie au niveau de l'ensemble du projet. On nous a demandé de vous parler ce soir de la relation entre piétons, espaces et événements à partir d'un projet qu'on a réalisé, qui est la place des festivals au centre-ville de Montréal. Donc, je vous amène à la transformation d'un lieu, puis vous montrer un peu comment on a transformé cet espace-là et en fonction de quelles valeurs on a travaillé aussi cette transformation-là. Alors, la Place des Festivals, c'est un espace, c'est pas strictement un projet d'aménagement, c'est un projet qui s'inscrit à l'intérieur d'une perspective plus globale qui vise la réhabilitation de tout un secteur du centre-ville de Montréal. Pour ceux qui connaissent autour de la Place des Arts, il y avait là un no man's land, en fait, un milieu, un non-lieu urbain, un espace attenant au centre-ville, mais très peu fréquenté. Alors, les gens allaient au théâtre, à la Place des Arts. Il n'y avait pas de restaurant après les représentations. Donc, un milieu vraiment délaissé. Un milieu qui est un peu issu de l'urbanisme fonctionnaliste là, des années 60-70, le tout à l'automobile, où on a privilégié, effectivement, les grands réseaux de voirie. Alors, vous allez voir, au travers de cette transformation-là, c'est cette logique des boîtes qui sont imbriquées du plus général au plus particulier, mais en partageant la même philosophie au niveau du design de l'ensemble de l'espace. Alors, la Place des Festivals s'inscrit dans un projet plus global, vous l'avez compris, donc sorte de parcours au pourtour de la Place des Arts où la Place des Festivals a constitué la première phase. On va le voir tantôt, ça s'est réalisé très rapidement. On est en relation avec la promenade des artistes qu'on appelle maintenant, qui nous amène à un autre espace public. Je sais pas si... un autre espace public qui est face à l'Orchestre symphonique de Montréal, l'Esplanade Clark, et finalement la rue Sainte-Catherine, qui est la rue commerciale emblématique à Montréal, qui vient fermer la boucle. Donc, c'est un parcours, et la place des festivals constituait la première phase. Alors, annonce de la première phase en 2000, en fait, à l'automne 2007, et inauguration au début de l'été 2009. Donc, ça s'est réalisé assez rapidement. Donc, l'espace de la place des festivals, c'était un combat important. Il faut savoir que le Festival de jazz, Juste pour rire, tiennent des événements très importants dans cette partie du centre-ville de Montréal. Alors, pour eux, un grand projet asphalté où on peut rassembler le plus grand nombre de personnes aurait été le projet idéal. Alors, il fallait travailler cet équilibre entre l'espace végétalisé, l'espace en dur, éventuellement propice au grand rassemblement. Ce que vous voyez, les lignes en rouge, il fallait se préoccuper aussi des interfaces. Donc, autant pour la rue Sparks qu'on a marché tantôt, cette interrelation entre le bâti et l'espace public est primordiale. C'est aussi important que la surface même de cet espace-là. Donc, un travail qui appartient évidemment aux professionnels de modeler cet espace-là en fonction de différentes échelles et de mettre en branle avec les ingénieurs donc un grand projet qui devient aussi, d'une certaine manière, une pièce d'art public en plein cœur du centre-ville, mais qui a la fonction de pouvoir recevoir effectivement des événements importants. Donc, la place des festivals a comme particularité aussi qu'on s'est préoccupé de ce qu'on appelle en fait la troisième dimension. Souvent, quand on regarde des projets ou quand on juge des projets, on regarde des projets en plan, puis on se dit « Ah, ce projet-là est intéressant, c'est de la géométrie ». Dans le cas qui nous occupe ici, vous voyez que le plateau original ne faisait pas corps avec l'espace de la rue. On était beaucoup plus surélevé, ce qui fait qu'il est impératif de remodeler la topographie de manière à ce que la place des festivals s'inscrive dans la continuité de la rue comme telle. Et ce sont des éléments qu'on ne voit pas souvent sur papier, mais qui sont derrière le succès de cet espace-là. Donc, immédiatement, l'espace a pris sa configuration. Un autre élément important dans le cas de la place des festivals et souvent dans les transformations qu'on a fait, qu'on va vous présenter, intervenir en 2018, c'est aussi de construire le patrimoine de demain. Alors, pour nous, la modernité dans le traitement de l'espace était très importante, qu'on puisse savoir qu'on lègue aujourd'hui un patrimoine et qu'il y a une facture qui est résolument contemporaine. Alors, tout ça tient dans une série de préoccupations, la matérialité, la qualité des matériaux, faire en sorte aussi que cet espace-là ait une qualité quand il n'y a pas d'événement. Donc, on va le voir, la présence d'une fontaine, la plus grande fontaine interactive au Canada qui est sous l'ensemble de cet espace-là. La préoccupation au niveau de l'appareillage des matériaux. On a utilisé du granit, qui est un matériau très pérenne, un noble matériau qu'on a chez nous ici, qu'on utilise trop peu. Le design du mobilier urbain, qui se veut très sobre aussi, il doit supporter l'assaut de 25 000 personnes quand il y a des événements sur la place des festivals. La même chose au niveau de la fontaine. Donc, un travail, comme on l'a vu, du plus général jusque dans le moindre détail des éléments de mobilier urbain par une équipe qui a suivi, si vous voulez, le projet dans chacun de ces détails-là. Alors, comment faire un espace public aussi qui caractérise la place des festivals en termes de symbolique? On aurait fait une place publique dans un quartier des affaires, on l'aurait fait différemment. Alors, dans ce contexte-là, on s'est inspiré en termes de symbolique des rideaux de théâtre, les rideaux rouges, la plateforme en noir de la scène caractéristique dans tous les grands théâtres. Donc, les fontaines ont été éclairées en partie en rouge, en partie en blanc pour émuler les projecteurs de scène. Et toute une programmation a été pensée de façon à ce que cet espace-là s'anime d'elle-même le soir. Et c'est assez intéressant de voir les familles qui viennent se déplacer, alignées le long des bancs pour admirer tout simplement le spectacle des fontaines. Donc, c'est un travail en collégialité, évidemment, avec des équipes multidisciplinaires, architectes, ingénieurs. Et quand la contrainte ne paraît pas dans le projet, c'est qu'on a réussi. Donc, ça a l'air facile, mais il y a tout ça. Il y a 25 km de tuyaux sous la place des festivals. Alors, c'est un peu particulier pour mettre en branle cet élément-là. La notion d'échelle appartient évidemment à différents registres. À l'échelle urbaine, on a voulu créer un amphithéâtre, donc amener un landmark, donc cette mégastructure d'éclairage qui marque la place des festivals. Quand on voit des spectacles à la télévision, on comprend tout de suite que c'est sur la place des festivals parce qu'il y a ces grandes structures d'éclairage-là, donc qu'on va retrouver par ailleurs dans l'ensemble du quartier des spectacles. Le tapis de la place est un élément important, mais le périmètre est tout aussi important. Alors, la contrainte majeure dans le cas du centre-ville ici, c'est que le Musée d'art contemporain de Montréal présentait une façade complètement aveugle. En fait, il s'agissait d'entreposage qu'on ne pouvait pas animer à même l'espace du musée. Alors, on a imaginé les vitrines habitées. Alors, on a à l'intérieur même de l'emprise du domaine public, on a construit deux cubes qui comportent environ 64 places assises à l'intérieur. La même chose en terrasse à l'extérieur. Et c'est devenu, dans le fond, ces vitrines habitées-là, des espaces un peu privilégiés pour les gens qui vont au théâtre. Donc, on va manger. Et on a eu la chance aussi que nos meilleurs restaurateurs, Norman Laprise de chez Toquet à Montréal, pour ceux qui connaissent, s'est implanté. Donc, ça a donné tout de suite une forme de standing au niveau du quartier des spectacles. Donc, on vit une expérience architecturale, une expérience théâtrale, la transparence de la place avec la partie animée du restaurant et le restaurant, par ailleurs, qui vient animer l'espace de la place. Donc, d'une façade morte, on a créé une façade vivante. Pour nous, c'est très important au niveau de l'ensemble. Alors, la place des festivals a été immédiatement appropriée par la population. Les fontaines ont servi de fond de scène pour Moment Factory, notamment, qui a fait des spectacles avec les mêmes fontaines. Et Montréal en lumière a créé des installations hivernales qui deviennent maintenant un point focal. Donc, on utilise l'espace public l'hiver sur la place des festivals et c'est devenu une forme de landmark pour Montréal de manière générale. Alors, oui, il y a des événements qui sont planifiés. Il y a des événements qui sont spontanés comme ça, qui se tiennent sur la place. J'aime bien cette photo. C'est un journaliste du New York Times, un dimanche matin, qui marchait à Montréal comme ça, qui a pris cette photo, qui montre, dans le fond, la présence de cet espace-là en mode beaucoup plus calme. Alors, 25 000 personnes qui se rassemblent sur un espace. Et tout de suite après, des moments d'intimité où les enfants vont arpenter cet espace-là avec des familles. Donc, un espace qui a un caractère urbain. La place des festivals, tout seul, elle est inscrite dans l'ensemble du réseau dont je parlais tantôt, qui partage les mêmes éléments en termes de signature. Alors, la promenade des artistes qui a été récupérée là, à même l'asphalte des éléments de voirie, avec des stratégies architecturales, souvent, qui ne sont pas nécessairement des éléments de cadre bâti. Ce que vous voyez ici à droite, ce sont des structures qu'on a appelées les vitrines éphémères, qui permettent de créer une certaine échelle au niveau de l'espace. Et ces mêmes structures-là sont utilisées pour créer différents événements. On voit aussi que le mobilier urbain, les éléments d'éclairage appartiennent au même langage que l'ensemble du projet. Alors, comme la place des festivals, il y a là des rassemblements spontanés qui se tiennent. Et à Montréal, pour ceux qui connaissent, c'est intéressant maintenant, le printemps, il y a un happening, des balançoires s'installent dans les structures. C'est un artiste qui a réalisé ça. Et depuis 5 ans, quand les balançoires arrivent, bien, c'est le printemps qui arrive à Montréal, en même temps que les pommetiers qui arrivent en fleurs. Alors, c'est devenu un événement. La promenade se poursuit sur le parterre, un espace plus végétalisé, mais qui a aussi une ponction avec des éléments de brouillard au niveau de l'ensemble de l'espace. Et finalement, le parcours se termine avec une contrainte qui n'était pas simple, le réaménagement de la rue Sainte-Catherine. Les gens des festivals voulaient pouvoir utiliser la rue Sainte-Catherine comme un plateau scénique. Et en même temps, il fallait conserver la circulation automobile, le stationnement en mode hors-événement, donc l'automne, l'hiver essentiellement. Alors, on a reconfiguré complètement la rue. Ça paraît qu'on est des architectes, on prend des photos avec pas beaucoup de monde pour voir les détails, mais il y en a beaucoup. Alors, mais vous voyez un peu la stratégie ici, donc les bollards qui permettent de délimiter, dans le fond, le trottoir piétonnier de la voirie comme telle, qui fait en sorte qu'en mode événement, cet espace-là, donc on peut enlever l'ensemble de ces bollards-là et la rue devient donc une place publique en continuité. Donc, on voit que le prolongement avec la place des spectacles. Et parmi le, en fait, pendant le plus grand festival, le festival de jazz, tous les espaces que je vous ai présentés sont remplis à capacité, au-delà de 200 000 personnes là, qui se concentrent au niveau de l'ensemble du quartier. Alors, on voit ici le mobilier urbain. Une contrainte intéressante, il fallait pouvoir déplacer l'ensemble du mobilier. Donc, on a pensé un élément en béton avec donc une sorte de lest qui permet de déplacer le mobilier au niveau de l'espace public. Ils s'en servent même maintenant pour se protéger des camions béliers lors des grands rassemblements sur l'espace public. Et vous reconnaissez quand même un côté un peu plus lounge dans ce mobilier-là. Donc, on est sorti du mobilier urbain caractéristique pour aller dans quelque chose d'un peu plus ludique. Et qui peut être aménagé, dans le fond, de façon quasi domestique au niveau de l'ensemble de l'espace. En terminant, c'est beaucoup d'ingrédients, un quartier, un projet comme celui-là. La notion d'éclairage est importante. Les mégastructures deviennent un landmark au niveau du projet, mais même l'éclairage fonctionnel de rue, l'éclairage urbain, est inspiré des treillis caractéristiques qu'on trouve dans le monde du spectacle, qui permet d'accrocher les différents projecteurs. Donc, on a, avec les designers industriels chez nous, dessiné cet élément de mobilier où vous reconnaissez, dans le fond, l'appartenance à la fonction plus spécifique pour le luminaire de rue et pour la chandelle. Alors, bon, il y a des cabinets scénographiques. Donc, tout le design est soigné jusque la taille de ces éléments-là de mobilier. Alors, peut-être une grande victoire par rapport à ce projet-là. C'est un projet qui fonctionne très bien en mode événement. Maintenant, il y a des événements, là, c'est en continu du début de l'été jusqu'à la fin. Mais c'est aussi un espace public significatif. Il y avait beaucoup de terrains vacants autour de la place des festivals. Donc, pour un projet global dans le cadre du quartier des spectacles de l'ordre de 120 millions de dollars, il y a 2,4 milliards de retombées économiques actuellement en développement autour de la place des festivals. Alors, René va continuer la présentation. Merci.
Alors, merci, grand plaisir d'être ici. Stanley nous a demandé de réfléchir aussi aux facteurs de succès, en fait, de ces grands projets de réhabilitation urbaine qui s'appliquent nécessairement aussi à la rue Sparks. Oh, j'ai perdu mon image. Donc, on a essayé de distiller, ça fait maintenant près de 30 ans, là, j'ai une image qui est bonne, donc t'es pas bonne. Hey, on y arrive, bon. Donc, on s'est questionné sur ces opérations de réhabilitation urbaine. Premier constat, en fait, puisqu'on fait ça depuis maintenant près de 30 ans, c'est que ce sont des opportunités civiques d'exception. Ces projets, on les fait à tous les 50 ans, en fait, sont supposés durer 50 ans, si je puis dire, et donc, ils impliquent une responsabilité civique assez importante. Réal le mentionnait, donc, le quartier des spectacles a permis la transformation d'un grand pan de ville. Donc, ce sont des responsabilités civiques majeures. C'est important d'investir les argents adéquats dans ces projets-là, de réaliser des projets de qualité. Donc, d'une opération de 120 millions, on a généré 2,2 milliards de retombées. Autre exemple, le quartier international de Montréal, un des premiers projets qui a été réalisé par la firme de grande réhabilitation urbaine, où, là encore, les éléments d'importance ont été la création de lieux de qualité pour retisser les tissus urbains entre le Vieux-Montréal et le centre des affaires. Des lieux de qualité, travailler avec des matériaux de qualité à l'échelle des piétons pour créer des environnements confortables. On insiste, en fait, sur cette notion-là. Encore une fois, donc, le projet du quartier international, lui, a généré, avec près de 90 millions d'investissements, aussi quelques 2 milliards de retours sur l'investissement. Que les projets soient en milieu urbain ou en milieu riverain, par exemple, comme la promenade Samuel de Champlain, les retombées peuvent être vraiment importantes. Par exemple, la promenade Samuel de Champlain a permis d'augmenter le tourisme de façon importante là, au niveau du projet, avec près de 2,6 millions de visiteurs. Les règles du jeu, d'après nous, après donc 30 ans d'expérience là-dedans, c'est évidemment créer une vision mobilisatrice, investir les sommes d'argent adéquates, réaliser des projets de qualité qui deviendront des lieux de destination et qui permettront donc de générer des retours sur un investissement important. Comme on dirait en anglais, « good design is good business ». Ce qui est important aussi, c'est que ces projets-là, on les fait pour les usagers. Alors, les usagers, et non à la gloire des architectes ou des designers urbains qui participent au projet. Alors, pour nous, c'est important de réaliser des projets qui vont être, après coup, adoptés par les usagers d'un lieu, que ce soit au niveau des espaces publics créés, au niveau de l'architecture des bâtiments qui sont réalisés. Pour nous, c'est très important et c'est vraiment un gage de succès quand on inaugure nos projets. Autre élément, excusez, j'ai de la misère avec moi. Bon. Autre élément d'importance, le génie du lieu. Ça, on insiste vraiment beaucoup sur cet élément-là. Par exemple, au niveau de la réhabilitation de la rue Sparks, elle est à Ottawa, elle n'est pas à Montréal, elle n'est pas à Québec. C'est vraiment un lieu, en fait, qui a sa personnalité spécifique. Le génie du lieu, ça nous permet de travailler avec le potentiel évocateur d'un site pour vraiment faire en sorte que l'on puisse révéler sa personnalité spécifique. Ça permet de réinterpréter de façon contemporaine, telle que dans la promenade Samuel de Champlain, des pans d'histoire vraiment importants, comme par exemple toute la vie industrielle, les empilements de bois qu'on avait dans le site. Ça permet, évidemment, tel qu'à la place des canotiers, de réaliser vraiment des interventions qui sont ancrées dans le génie du lieu et dans la personnalité spécifique, finalement, du contexte. Autre élément d'importance, la signature paysagère. C'est un de nos constats aujourd'hui quand on se promenait sur la rue Sparks. En fait, il n'y a pas beaucoup d'aménagements paysagers, il n'y a pas beaucoup d'arbres. La signature paysagère, elle est importante parce qu'il faut absolument redonner les lettres de noblesse, en fait, au paysage en milieu urbain. Trop souvent, en fait, on réalise des aménagements qui sont très minéraux, si vous voulez, au niveau des espaces publics. Et la signature paysagère permet vraiment de créer un environnement enveloppant pour l'usager, défini à une échelle appropriée. Et évidemment, aujourd'hui, avec toutes les questions environnementales qui sont discutées et le développement durable, c'est vraiment un élément d'importance dans le design de ces projets. La signature architecturale, elle est aussi importante. En fait, ma collègue faisait référence à l'importance de l'architecture parce qu'elle permet de cadrer les espaces publics, cette couche signature architecturale. On peut aussi assurer le prolongement des espaces publics entre l'extérieur et l'intérieur pour vraiment animer le plus possible les espaces. On peut aussi connecter le sol et le sous-sol de plusieurs espaces publics pour vraiment, encore une fois, animer le plus possible l'ensemble de ces lieux. L'idée étant, à la fin, d'avoir une perméabilité complète entre l'intérieur et l'extérieur et de vraiment, encore une fois, animer ces lieux le plus possible. La signature lumière, c'est important. Vous l'avez un peu vu dans le cadre du quartier des spectacles, mais elle est plus que signature lumière fonctionnelle. C'est-à-dire qu'en travaillant une lumière scénographique, par exemple, en éclairant des fontaines, des éléments de brume, des pavés brumes, etc., on peut créer des ambiances qui sont vraiment magiques et qui deviennent un élément attractif pour la fréquentation des projets de réhabilitation urbaine. En termes de mobilier urbain, c'est aussi une couche importante puisque les espaces publics, on s'y promène, on les fréquente, on y marche, on veut venir s'y asseoir, on veut devenir en quelque sorte aussi parfois observateur de l'animation urbaine. Donc, ces éléments de mobilier urbain sont vraiment importants et doivent être définis ou designés à une échelle appropriée en fonction, évidemment, de l'échelle du lieu. On parle ici de bancs, de supports à vélo, d'éléments d'éclairage, de poubelles. Il ne faut pas négliger aucun des éléments associés au milieu urbain. Au mobilier urbain pour créer un environnement cohérent. Quand on développe des espaces publics, on crée un canevas permanent. L'idée étant, après coup, que ce canevas soit habité par de l'art public, en fait, qui permet vraiment de mettre en vitrine la culture d'une communauté, d'un environnement, d'un voisinage. On s'est aperçu dans le cadre de nos différents projets comment le pouvoir attractif de ces éléments est important. Moi, j'ai de la misère. Excusez-moi. Excusez-moi. Alors, que ce soit au niveau des installations d'art public à l'extérieur, à l'intérieur, par exemple, dans le cadre de réseaux piétonniers protégés, ou même, en fait, des interventions... pardon encore une fois, d'interventions réalisées donc de façon éphémère. Les éléments de mobilier urbain sont vraiment, d'art public sont vraiment importants. Aujourd'hui, on nous demandait, et qu'est-ce qui arrive pour les enfants? On s'est rendu compte qu'avec le temps, ces éléments d'art public étaient vraiment fréquentés, utilisés par les enfants de façon importante. La signature graphique, c'est un élément donc à l'échelle, si vous voulez, une échelle microscopique, mais qui permet encore une fois de créer un ensemble très cohérent, donc au niveau de tout ce qui est signalisation et wayfinding strategy, si je puis me permettre. Un des éléments avec lequel on aime le plus travailler, on n'a pas trouvé encore la version hivernale de cet élément-là, c'est ce qu'on appelle nos éléments de signature cinétique. L'archétype, en fait, d'un élément de signature cinétique, c'est la fontaine, mais on travaille beaucoup avec les éléments de brume, de feu, comme ici autour de la joute de Jean-Paul Riopel. Les grands caniveaux de brume qui sont éclairés de soir, en fait, et qui créent des ambiances complètement magiques. Et évidemment, les fontaines, l'archétype traditionnel de, si vous voulez, ces éléments cinétiques, qui font en sorte qu'ils deviennent des éléments très ludiques dans le cadre des projets et qui créent un visage pour nos lieux publics qui sont distinctifs, évidemment associés avec la signature éclairage des projets. On a développé avec le temps donc des éléments, par exemple, Réal présentait la fontaine du quartier des spectacles qui implique beaucoup de mécanique, mais il y a maintenant d'autres stratégies comme par exemple les pavés brumes qui permettent de réaliser des interventions avec moins d'efforts techniques. Donc, très ludique au niveau des projets. Matérialité, durabilité, c'est un élément important. Il faut absolument investir dans la qualité et utiliser donc des matériaux qui seront bien passés à travers le temps parce que ces interventions, on les réalise pour les 50 prochaines années. On a au Québec, au Canada, des matériaux fantastiques, le granit, le calcaire. On ne les utilise pas assez souvent dans le cadre de ces projets. La flexibilité, c'est tout de même important. On en parlait pour permettre donc la liberté d'occupation de ces grands espaces urbains pour des événements, pour des modes, en fait, plus personnalisés. On doit offrir la flexibilité quand on veut que les lieux soient utilisables en mode véhiculaire versus en mode piéton. Donc, l'élément de flexibilité est important et on doit créer ces canevas publics, ces espaces publics, pour permettre donc l'installation d'activités éphémères telles qu'on le voyait avec les œuvres d'art publiques. Vous avez un projet fantastique, le projet de la rue Sparks. Et évidemment, si on avait quelques recommandations à faire, ce serait ce projet doit être travaillé en référence au génie de son lieu spécifique. C'est une rue qui est bien cadrée par des bâtiments d'une architecture qui sont quand même vraiment très intéressants. À l'heure actuelle, en fait, parce que c'est la troisième itération que vous allez faire pour le réaménagement de la rue Sparks, la notion d'investissement adéquat pour réaliser un projet de qualité pour que ça devienne un lieu de destination. Pour nous, c'est vraiment important afin de redonner à la rue l'élégance, en fait, de cette rue, parce que c'est une rue qui est élégante. Il y a trop d'éléments qui se sont rajoutés avec le temps. Et on dirait même, en fait, qu'il y a tout un travail topographique d'origami urbain à développer. Mais je pense que pour la rue Sparks, il faudrait vraiment même oser l'audace de la simplicité dans les nouvelles interventions. Merci beaucoup.
How are we doing out there? Good. Do we need to stand up and do a little quick? Everybody stand up. All right. Well, just stand up and rub your hands together. That's good. All right. Lead, turn to your right and just do a little massage on the person to your right. There we go. And then turn the other way, a little massage. Okay, that's all right. That's good. That's good. Well, thank you very much for being here tonight. And it's really an honor to be included with this great group and to talk about downtowns and about the things that we all love. My name is Ron Redman. I'm from Burlington, Vermont. And if you're not familiar with Burlington, it is about 2 hours south of here. It's on Lake Champlain. It's a college town. We are the second oldest state in the country. We are probably the second or third smallest state. We are also the gayest state. We have the highest proportion of gay couples, married couples, in any state in the United States. We are very liberal, progressive. Bernie Sanders is our U.S. Senator, Patrick Leahy. And we feel like we could just come to you. So you need to annex us. We're ready, Canada. Take us. Please, take us. Okay. All right. We're ready. All right. So as we look at our downtown, we have lots of people that are taking care of our downtown and our city, but we look for these things: walkability, transportation and parking, a lot of mixed-use development. We look for how do we add hospitality and tourism? We have strong neighborhoods. We have an entire program to work on neighborhoods in our city through our economic development office. And most of all, we have an engaged citizenry. It's not unusual for me to be on Church Street, which is a four-block pedestrian mall in Burlington, and have somebody come up to me and say, there's a loose brick over a block away, or there's a trash can that's full. Can you get to that? And we really like that people are that engaged. They really care a lot about their downtown, and they care about Church Street. So what is Church Street? Church Street is a street that has been active in Burlington's history for years. It was the natural corridor between the waterfront, where at one point we were the second largest lumber port in, I think, in the world. But the route to the woolen mills was from the lake was right up Church Street. And so you see the picture from 1865 and today, or 2017. A little bit's changed. It's Vermont. But this gives you an idea. This is from about 1907. This shows you the kind of bones that we have in Burlington. Still, a lot of our buildings were built in the 1800s and early 1900s. A lot of small footprints, so it's great for retail. As retail shrinks, we're finding that those spaces now are beneficial. So it gives us an opportunity. We have about 100 stores on our four-block pedestrian mall. This is Church Street back in the 1970s. It wasn't unusual at that time to find, we had gun shops, uniform stores, we had a JCPenney, we had Grant's, Sears, we had a Woolworth up until 2000. So it was a very sort of blue-collar, working downtown. And during the time of urban renewal, there were concerns by the city mothers and fathers that Burlington would be hurt if it didn't do something bold. And so the idea was to create the marketplace. And what happened was the internal blocks of Church Street, two blocks were closed off to pedestrian traffic in the 1980s. In the 1990s, we closed off the top block. And by 2005, we had closed off the entire street, the final block. So it's a four-block, quarter-of-a-mile-long stretch. It's in the heart of Burlington, and it gives you an idea of it's very linear, runs north-south. We have an interesting way of governance. In our country, business improvement districts, which is what we are generally governed or generally run by private nonprofit organizations. And we're unique. We're one of very few business improvement districts that's actually run by a municipality. In Vermont, people like government. People see the value of it. The further south of our country you drive, the less people value government. That's okay. So what we have is the marketplace department, which runs the day-to-day operations of Church Street, is actually, I report to the mayor. And my board, which is really the Church Street Marketplace Commission, is appointed by the city council. There are plans underfoot. We have a consultant in town that's looking at the possibility of creating a much larger downtown district that would encompass both Church Street and the rest of downtown, about a 20 square block area. And they're making some recommendations for that, and we're very excited to see what might unfold. So our mission, very important to us. It's something that we have hold near and dear to our hearts. This is something that was created back in 1981 when we founded, to provide responsible management leading to an economically successful downtown, which is vibrant, clean, and safe for the benefit of the fee payers. Those are the people, those are the property owners that pay 70% of my operating budget, community members, and visitors. So vibrant, clean, safe, we just say safe, clean, and fun. In my business, what's really important when you get right down to it, we're very tactical, we're very operations oriented, so we think a lot about safe, clean, and fun, and we think about just do your job. This is Bill Belichick. He's the coach for the New England Patriots. If you're in New England, you love the guy. If you're outside of New England, he's the devil. So, but he has a really good message. That's do your job. And that's what we try to do at the marketplace. We try to keep it really simple and remember that our job is safe, clean, and fun. And so when we think about safe, we think about the realities of our downtown. We have a high concentration of social services. We have populations that are suffering from mental illness and from drug addiction, alcohol addiction. And so they're using those services. They're in our downtown. We have 3 homeless shelters in our downtown. So it's a challenge to manage this. We have $1 million condos next to our homeless shelter. So, I mean, we're sort of managing and figuring out ways to do things. But what's most important for us is to build those good, strong relationships with public safety. That's me in the middle during Halloween. And these guys were embarrassed, but that's our downtown lieutenant and our battalion chief from the fire department. And I use this photo as just a way to illustrate how important it is to build those relationships and how much, when you have a good relationship with your public safety people, how much that benefits you in so many ways, and you're helping each other. We take community policing seriously. We don't put the cops at the center of the circle. We put them on the outside. They're a partner along with us, and we all take our responsibility when we're talking about community policing, and this just sort of illustrates our stakeholders. Back in the early 2000s, I joined in 1998, we had some challenges on our street, and we really needed to get people to services in a completely different way. We had what we called the Jerry Springer Show, where people were just acting out, and we wanted to get to Dr. Phil. We wanted to get a little more facilitative, a little more consultative, a little more calm. And so what we did is, we actually created a street outreach team. Today we have 4 full-time street outreach workers working 7 days a week and really helping those people maybe who have fallen in between the cracks or are just not willing to go to services to really work with them to help them get help. It's made a big difference. So let's go to clean. I just have one photo. And this is of 2 of our men. Gentleman on the right is Jim Daly, who's our maintenance foreman and marketing or maintenance director. What's really important for Church Street, the founding mothers and fathers, when they went out and looked at all these different pedestrian malls and took a visit across the country, was having a dedicated staff and a dedicated budget. Dedicated staff means you've got people that are there doing the maintenance, doing the work on a daily basis. So we have our team work only when people are on the street. We never have them do cleaning when people aren't there. We want our guests and citizens to see us working. And with snow removal, the same thing. But this team takes great pride in removing snow, keeping the street clean. It's very, very important. And it's something I think that it's remarkable. Most people know our maintenance team. They'll know their first names before they know me. And fun. We do the safe, we do this clean, and we do the fun. Come on, fun. There we go. Whoops. Having too much fun. Back. All right. It's impossible to think that you can do all of programming 365 days a year. So we use the strategy OPE, other people's events. Church Street, a 4-block pedestrian mall, is a stage. So what we do is encourage other organizations to come to our stage and to create an activity, create an event. And we've been very fortunate in over the years being home to a lot of very big events. We do certainly a lot on our own as well. We also have this strategy of 2 days is a lifetime. If somebody comes to us and says, hey, we got this idea, we just try to say, yeah, let's figure it out. Venus Williams was suddenly available to play tennis on Church Street with some youth groups. We had about 2 days to plan it. That little silver thing there, you probably recognize it. Boston won it back in, I don't know, fairly recently. But it was on Church Street. We didn't have much warning, but we just went with it. And that's the beauty of having a dedicated staff, is being able to be flexible and let's see, Goodness here. Oh, another great story. We have about 200 street performers that we license. They have to move to a different block each hour. These kids were doing breakdancing, and they were learning breakdancing. They're Vermont kids, but they were learning breakdancing from YouTube videos. And they came and talked to us and said, we want to do this on Church Street. We said, that's great. And so they built this great following, and now they're all professional dancers. But that's what you have to do is to find what you've got, find the local talent, and try to make the most of it. Our social media, we're very proud of that. We use a strategy of our posts are either business-related, they're about beauty, or they're about fun. And we try to keep things in those categories, and we try to be very disciplined about how often we post and what we say. We're very careful about grammar, and very careful in general. So guiding principles. Through all of this, the things that we sort of use to direct our business is road trips. We believe strongly in going out, visiting towns, visiting cities, learning from others, and inviting people to come visit with us. Road trips are very important, and that's one of the things that our founding mothers and fathers did when they put Church Street together, is they did a lot of travel. There's no silver bullet. We know that when we have, in an urban environment, we're making decisions to do things. Sometimes it's not just one thing, but it might be 10 things or 15 things, and they'll come at different times. We also know that a lot of our work is just, you know, looking for those gaps and filling them. A lot of our work during the day is people coming to us with problems and us being able to say, well, wait a minute, you know, I think we can figure this out, and to try to help people sort of cross those bridges. Starting slow and building. It's not uncommon for us, if somebody comes to us with an event or an idea, we try to start slow. We did a Mardi Gras parade that in its first year was a truck with a trailer. And then, you know, 20 years later, it's a 2-hour-long parade. But start slow and always declare victory. If you do an event, declare a victory. Just talk about how great it was, and then just keep building. No, you got to do that. It's really important. It's important to declare victory. All right. Have faith in yourself. Why not? Have faith in others. We have also a principle around strong partnerships. This can kind of freak out our contractors. We have a snow removal contractor and tree trimming service that helps us hang our lights. When we talk with them, we say, listen, we don't want a date, we want to get married. And they're like, what? But the idea is that we want a working relationship with our contractors that's serious, where we're both committed to really do the very best for Church Street and that they can benefit from as well. So those strong partnerships with your contractors is very important. Another thing is, I am what I am. It's what Popeye said. Don't try to be something that you're not. Just remember, you know, for us, we're a 4-block pedestrian mall in Burlington, Vermont. You know, and sometimes when we maybe think a little bit too big, we go, well, you know, just kind of keep in mind who you are. Also, when you do things, do it through the lens of making sure you're protecting your reputation and your brand. That goes with the kind of partners you choose. It goes with the kind of events that you do. It's very important. And you're human, you make mistakes. You know, you move on. And also, if you're going to do something, do it well. Do the very, very best that you can do. Or don't do it. If you feel like you can't do something, don't do it. Your instincts are probably right. And finally, the biggest one is be relevant. It's something we worry about constantly. The internet is causing great competition for our retailers. There are many more choices in our community. There's many more places besides our downtown to go to. How do we continue to be relevant? How do we continue to be top of mind for consumers? So what's it all about? This business of business improvement districts. It's about the experience. That's so important to remember that. I tell my staff that constantly. It doesn't matter. We're really, you know, what do we do? How we empty a trash can, how we clean a street. It's about the experience that people have. The retail apocalypse, yes, it is challenging, but one of the things we have to do is to find creative ways to get people to retail. And again, it's about experience. We've had a great time with something called Shop and Sip, where we bring alcohol vendors, beer, wine, spirits into different participating retail stores where people can sample alcohol and shop. And it surprisingly has been a very popular event. But it's that kind of thing. It's how do you, you know, how do you get people to come to retail? And about 70% of our stores are locally owned. We also feel that lighting is so important, and we had seen all these lighting installations across the world, and we knew we had very little money, so we kind of saved up our money, and we've been buying lights over time. But during the winter months, it's important to have light, because we get kind of down, and lights really build our spirits. So when people tell us these stories of, hey, I was walking home, I was working late, I was walking on Church Street, and I saw the lights, thank you very much. That just warms our hearts, because we know that we're getting people, we're delighting them. So we know it's about the experience. We also know it's about women. It's all about women. Our street is feminine. Our downtown is feminine. It's a place where women love to go. And our motto is, build it for women, and the men will follow. And you know that's true, men. And men, you also know that women have much higher standards than men. So you have to be attentive to that. They're making the purchasing decisions. And there's a great book a colleague of mine, David Feehan, wrote with several others, Design Downtown for Women, Men Will Follow. The whole point is that men are mostly designing downtowns, but they're not necessarily understanding what women want or need. Just watch a woman in high heels in a downtown environment like this. We can do better. So there's probably lots to say about that. One thing I will say is that Bryant Park, a place that we look at a lot and steal ideas from in New York City, does something interesting. They've done it for years. They count the number of people in the park every day, and they count the number of men, and they count the number of women, because they know that the more women that are in a public space, the safer it is. It's just how it is. So it's interesting that they're still doing this. And we're certainly very, we learned from that. We're certainly very attentive to that as well. Let's see here. Okay, women bring children and families when they feel safe. Three, so we got experience, we got women, we got locals. It's about respecting locals. One of our philosophies is build it for locals and the tourists will come. Don't do an event for tourists. Don't ever do an event for tourists. Do an event because it's good for locals. That's what we seek when we're out vacationing, right? We want the authentic. We want, what are the locals doing? Well, just keep that in mind. It's something that we've tried to do through our event planning. And finally, so we've got experience, we've got women, we've got locals, and we've got weird. Weird is really important. Every community has a certain amount of weird. You know, we've got a certain amount of grit, a certain amount of je ne sais quoi, I don't know. But it's really important to remember and sort of evoke your inner weirdness. And that sort of makes you more authentic. This is a picture of a guy in Portland, Oregon. I'm not sure what he's doing, but he's on a ball. And actually, this is a video, but he's wearing a diaper, and he's got a bagpipe. With every time he blows it, flames come out of it. And my point is to illustrate this, is that weird is okay. Weird is good. Different. That's what downtowns are about. That's what, that's what we do here. We bring a lot of different people together, and we enjoy each other's company. We do our best to try. We wouldn't be much if we didn't measure our performance. We look at our sales. We don't get to see the sales of our stores, but we ask our retailers every year if they're up, down, or even. We look at metrics. We look at the gross, the receipts, rooms and meals taxes, and we track those to try to understand how we're doing versus the rest of the city and the state and some of our competing areas that have a lot of dining. We have over 110 eating and drinking establishments in a 20 square block area. We look at our retail sales. We look at hotel rooms. All this information is very important and helps us to understand how we're doing. There we go. Another important metric for us is crime. So we get a lot of data from Burlington Police Department, and we have a pretty active intern program through the University of Vermont. And they help us crunch numbers, but we look a lot at these the green areas, other calls for service. That's disorderly conduct, panhandling, some of the quality of life issues. And so we look very carefully at that, and also some of the other factors, drug and alcohol issues, property, and violent crime. So, Gesundheit. We look very closely at social media. We're really proud of that. This is something else we do, and have done it ever since 2005. Every year we ask our businesses to rate us in terms of how we market, our maintenance, administration, licensing, and security. So we ask a series of questions. It's about a 10-minute survey they can do online through SurveyMonkey. But it really helps us to see how we're doing. And it's interesting, the number one thing, number one area we always get high marks is maintenance. And the maintenance guys are so proud of that, but it's really important. You know, if you're trying to attract women to your street, if you say, you know, that's what you want, you've got to have a clean environment. It's got to be safe. You have to keep working on that. You can never, and I think as you said, it's never done. You know, you're always doing the work. And finally, can't say enough about the International Downtown Association. What a great organization for us. We've been members since the 80s, and it's certainly inspired us and given us an opportunity to meet so many different people from both the United States, Canada, and around the world. What's great about our business is we share ideas a lot. We steal from each other. And that's it. That's us. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup. I don't know whether everyone realizes the quality and the caliber of speakers that we have tonight is really quite spectacular, and we're thrilled that you were all accepted our invitation and that you came here. So I'd like to give one more hand for all of our speakers. And now it's up to you, donc à vous la parole. So we have two microphones, one set up over here and one over here. Anyone who wants to ask a question, please feel free, step up to one of the mics. Donc, on a deux microphones sur les deux coins ici. Soyez à l'aise à demander vos questions dans la langue de votre choix. Et on va commencer ici avec la première question, first question over here.
Thank you very much. Is the mic's on now?
Yeah.
Thank you. Very interesting session, and congratulations to the NCC for organizing these labs. I have a question for Cynthia. It is, what is your opinion about the concept of hierarchy of users? I asked the question because in this area we've got an increasingly serious problem of conflict between cyclists and pedestrians in shared places. A good illustration is the NCC currently is redesigning the surface of one of our major bridges, trying to make it compatible for use by cyclists, pedestrians, and cars. They're designing in a substantial physical barrier between the car lane and the bike path, but they've refused to have any kind of physical demarcation between the bike path and the pedestrian area. Even a gradation differential. The reason being that given is that if cyclists get in each other's way, they need an escape valve and they can veer into the pedestrians, which obviously ignores or in fact reverses what normally is considered to be the hierarchy of users. So the question is that something that ought to be ignored? Is it a useless concept? Or does the concept have some value as a design principle in things like resurfacing bridges?
Thank you. Just start talking.
Just start talking. Okay, great. Thank you for your question. We always design and prioritize the most vulnerable users first. So that's pedestrians and cyclists, then transit, then cars, then trucks. So you don't have 2,000, you know, pounds of metal around you, or even on a bicycle. So the pedestrians in that way really are the most vulnerable, should be prioritized. Cyclists have clubs, they have advocacy groups, they have cool clothing that they buy. Pedestrians don't have any of that. We don't have any, you know, sort of like affinity groups or like, we just are out there walking. And cyclists are kind of more organized in that way. So that's another reason to prioritize pedestrians. there's different kinds of cyclists. I mean, you're talking about the spandex guys, the spandex crowds that are like going 60, you know, kilometers an hour on their way somewhere, we don't know where, versus the family out for a stroll on a, for a ride on a Sunday, or just the more casual cyclist. And so, you know, that's again, it's sort of like delineating where the spandex crowd, they don't want me. They don't want me walking my dog in front of them. So are there other routes for them to take? Or if it's a congested area going over a bridge, they walk their bikes. We've seen that a lot, where cyclists must dismount if you're going over a bridge, which is kind of a, you don't want anyone falling into the roadway. You know, that's like, you're not supposed to be going fast over a bridge. That's just not a good idea. So there's ways of educating cyclists about understanding what their responsibility is. Sharing the road, you know, is about people and people. Also looking at, maybe we didn't give enough space for the, you know, we still have too much space for the cars, because when pedestrians and cyclists are fighting over space, it's because we gave too much to the automobiles. So kind of reconceiving that. Then you look at places like Copenhagen, where people just, like, they take their kids and they've got the cargo bikes and they're cycling with in high heels to work in the wintertime. And that's just kind of the daily way of, and that's a much more sort of balanced way of cycling. So it's like, the more it becomes part of a way of life, and the more people that do it that are not just out to race and mow down pedestrians, that the culture changes. So you're still in that, you haven't quite gotten to that tipping point yet. But certainly I think some respectful education and some just principles about dismount, you know, if you're in a crowded area, might work.
I'd like to just expand on that question a little bit about pedestrian streets. And so, since we have this great panel, currently on Spark Street, correct me if I'm wrong, cyclists are not supposed to be riding their bikes along Spark Street. They're supposed to dismount and walk their bikes. That's a contentious issue about how do you have, if it's wide enough and there is some reserved space, I don't know how it works in Burlington. And I don't know, René and Réal, how you work that into. There's some of the, I saw that on St. Catherine, the street, there's demarcations within the paving. So I'd be interested in hearing a comment about that, since it's similar to that question. Anyone want to take that on? Ron, why don't you start? Yeah,
cycling is big for us. The community is installing complete streets and bike lanes, and so culturally, we're really trying to change. We're trying to change and alter the culture to be more bicycle friendly, but not on Church Street. If they have to walk their bike, and there's still people that like to, you know, speed down, but generally, I'd say generally people, if they are riding the bike, it's a $50 fine. I don't think the police ever enforce it, but it's not permitted, so.
Thanks. Any other comments?
It's always a very challenging topic, I must say. I do agree with Cynthia, you know, it would be fantastic if we could be as civilized as in Copenhagen, where everybody's kind of respectful towards the other people. Pedestrian movements, and we did try some strategies in the theater district, meaning that, you know, when people were coming through on the Maisonneuve, we tried to slow them down, but it's a dedicated bike path. We often call it the bike highway, which is not a good thing next to, you know, a public square as what we have. So we try with, you know, kind of lights and, you know, bike lights and so on, but it's a challenging, but I do think that education is really, is a key element to these projects, for sure.
Okay, thank you. We have another question.
We saw a lot of pictures of water fountains, and I'd like to ask our visitors from Montreal what happens during the winter.
During wintertime, we have to close off the fountains, but they're open, let's say, as the start of the spring, let's say in April, and then, let's say, late October, we close down the system. So that's why I was saying we're trying to imagine and create and design these winter systems that would be, you know, as interesting and powerful as the, having said this, the fountains, as we were saying, you know, need more technical support. The mist pavers that you've seen in Place des Canadiens and so on, is lighter in terms of, you know, technological demand. So it's a great element that you could do. You don't need the mechanical rooms that are needed for fountains. So, but we have to shut them down. Yeah, that's part of life in our climate.
Okay. Question suivante. Next question.
The focus I've heard seems to have been on streets and street life and the importance to social life in cities and urban areas. I'm tempted to ask about Spark Street, but what I'm really more interested in is the role of the public square. Squares seem to be lacking in the Anglo tradition. Certainly Ottawa is lacking in public squares. I don't consider Confederation Square to be relevant to the urban experience. First of all, it's not even square. But it's more of an island, a ceremonial island. I've always felt Ottawa needs public squares. I'm wondering what your experience is in terms of squares and how they contribute to urban life.
I must say they contribute a lot to, let's say, the public life and the urban life. Even in Montreal, we had these squares, let's say, when we talk about Place des Festivals in the theater district. So we had we have quite a few squares because in Montreal, the way the city has developed is that we were building squares and then it was densified around it. Actually, that was how Montreal really evolved, and which is a great thing. We find this is a fantastic way of doing a city. So we do have quite a few squares, let's say historical ones. We've worked some of these squares like Place Jean-Paul Riopelle and Square Victoria, but they have their very specific personality, if I may say so. On Place des Festivals, what's interesting is that it became the official square for major event. So when we win the Stanley Cup, which never happens, but necessarily, you know,
it used to happen.
The event would start there. When there are major events, so it became really kind of a destination point for major events, starting points for, you know, all sorts of things, marathon during the weekend and so on. So they're really interesting and necessary, but this is kind of a public gathering square, if I may say so. The other ones are more, how would I say this, you know, kind of, they're part of the urban life, but it's almost as if they are auto-sufficient in themselves. For instance, Place Jean-Paul Riopelle with La Joute de Jean-Paul Riopelle, with the fountain, the fire circle, and the benches and the trees. It's almost an auto-sufficient square, very inhabited, but Place des Festivals is really, and Ottawa, it would be great if you guys could have one. They're really important spaces, I must say.
Anyone else want to?
I'll just add, for our community, we're sort of very protest driven, in a good way. I mean, you know, people are really engaged. So Church Street becomes the public square for demonstrations and protests and rallies and parades. Whenever there's a national tragedy, people will gather on Church Street. If there's an issue that the current presidential administration is dealing with that you know, that people don't agree with, they'll go there and they'll go they'll protest. We, it's a lot. It's busy. We're very busy right now. but for us, it's very important. We have our First Amendment, and we feel like we have to be very strong advocates for people to express themselves. And sometimes people express themselves in ways that you know, is distasteful to the general public. But we have to protect those rights just as much as anyone else's. But it is very much important to us.
Okay.
Thank you. I want to thank the whole board, whole panel for a very interesting presentation, and the NCC for having this forum. But my question comes from something that Ron said about designing it for women. I'd be interested in hearing everybody's comments on public bathrooms and making this accessible.
It came up. We had a session with our staff earlier today, and that was one of the questions that came up. So so who wants to tackle the gotta go movement? And the
OK, I'm going to start, and then the rest of you guys have to fill in. We had public bathrooms. We had public restrooms in our shopping mall, but that's under construction. Actually, much of it has been demolished, and a new building is being built, so we don't currently have public restrooms. It's a problem. We're looking at various possibilities. One is, can we go to a private business is there someone that has restrooms which we can then contract with them? But one of the things we know for sure that if we have public restrooms, they need to be staffed. As long as they're open, there needs to be humans. And I think, for each different type of bathroom that you have, you need to have an individual that's really monitoring. It's so important, and it needs to be stocked and cleaned on an almost hourly basis. And we haven't solved that yet. There's a great report that Denver did, a great study that Denver did on its public restrooms and analysis, and it's certainly a great template for other cities. I'll share that with Stanley, but we don't have the answer, and we don't have public restrooms in our downtown right now, which is a bummer.
No pissoirs.
No pissoirs.
Oh my God.
Yeah. No. I know. That's.
So there's a company in San Antonio, Texas. This guy has his own business. It's called the Royal Flush. And it is a portable toilet, and it has like marble sinks and flowers and brass fittings. And he comes to events, and he just rolls this thing up, and he manages it, and he's there for a few hours. And it's like the most gorgeous bathroom you've ever seen. So this is actually a business model, for an entrepreneur. No, you don't pay because he's paid by the event organizer to come and bring this facility rather than paying the porta potties or the porta johns. Yeah, so it's very elegant. The thing with wherever you site the bathrooms, you should put them, where there's a lot of people that are going to use them, and also where they're visible, either to a business, a merchant, a ticket taker, a ticket seller, station master, and a train station. There has to be eyes on the facility, and there has to be somebody that's sort of charged with, keeping an eye on it. So it can't be sort of buried in the back. It's got to be really front and center and visible, so more people will use it. And there's, just kind of different ways of, sometimes you've heard of bike-friendly communities or bike-friendly businesses, that there might be businesses that are not at are fine with letting people use their restroom, like most gas stations are, and perhaps there's some sort of a benefit for them to do that in terms of maybe reduced taxes or a little incentive. If you let your people use your bathroom, we'll give you a break on such and such and such and such. So there could be ways of working with local merchants as well with regards to that. I think I'll stop there.
Anything? One of the things this afternoon that Rene had mentioned is that in the pre-planning of some of the projects, so maybe you want to just talk about that, the infrastructure is there when the money or the ideas come through. So
yeah, let's say in the theater district, so we plan, kind of the public infrastructure to be able to, to have portables and connect these portables. So when we have a lot of people during the festivals, we have these portables in very strategic locations, and they're operated, let's say, by the organization in charge of the festival itself. But it's always a challenge, I must say, and nobody wants to maintain them. We're always looking for public buildings where we could locate more washrooms, but it's who's going to take care of these washrooms, maintain them, and pay for them, etc. So as you're saying, it should be a business model, where these organizations could be hired during these events. But yeah.
You have another question?
Thank you for your very interesting presentations. The City of Ottawa has a pedestrian-first policy. It's had that policy for over 20 years. But a few steps away from here is the Byward Market. It's an heritage conservation district. It's where the City of Ottawa started. And this is where it's a major, actually, pedestrian destination. It's got very high volumes of pedestrians. But this is where you will find, in the middle of the sidewalk, hydrants, hydro poles, light poles, you will find actually that some sidewalks at intersections don't meet on the other side with other sidewalks, or sometimes there is no sidewalk on the other side. And this is where the city of Ottawa actually rents public space, the little, because these streets are very narrow, because they are the first streets built in Ottawa. The city of Ottawa actually rents the street, the public space on the sidewalk to private restaurant bar owners, and in which actually they post, I don't know, their, what they sell, and they put their A-frames, and the residents actually have done a couple of times sort of walkability audits and showing that actually pedestrians have to walk on the street because there's so many obstacles actually. So the city of Ottawa is doing actually a public realm plan for the Byron Market. It's not happening within a framework of any kind. It's not, there's no vision that chapeaued actually this plan. So anyway, I'm just wondering, knowing that actually the city has had this policy for the longest time of putting pedestrians first, why is it that, you know, this is still happening, just steps away? And do you think actually that there's a chance without having a vision that you can actually create a public realm, you do a public realm plan without an overall arching vision of what you're trying to achieve, and I'm just asking, because we as residents actually are concerned about the fact that it's not fitting into any general overall
Thank you. Planning. It's an open-ended question. Who?
Very, very good question, I must say. And this is the way our cities are structured. I'm not talking about Ottawa, I don't know, but let's say Montreal and Quebec, there's a lot of silo thinking. You were talking about this afternoon. You have, let's say, the urban design department, the landscape department, the architectural, they're not necessarily talking to each other. So that's one of the problems, that's for sure. What's interesting with these urban renewal operations is that you could think about, kind of the global vision. And one of the first things that we do, and it struck Rianne and I when we were walking on Spark Street, is often we say we have to do a cleanup. For instance, in the international district, there were so many elements, like you have a lighting fixture, then you have, let's say, a stop next to it, then you have signage on a post, and then you have like 3, 4, 5 posts. Same thing in the theater district. One of the main item is to say, okay, how could we clean this up and only have one pole, let's say, as in the theater district, that will hang the signage, the light, the traffic lights, and everything, so we don't really clutter, all of the public space. But it does need a global vision to organize all of that, and a lot of sensitivity associated to that. And even what Riel was showing, the mega lighting structure in the theater district, they were done that way because they were super high to frame the outside theater to really have less, let's say, obstacles within the public realm. And that was the intent, just to free up, kind of the ground from all of these elements, which are very annoying. So that, but it, to me, it does take a global vision to do that. It's necessary at the beginning of a project.
I'm gonna go out on a ledge here, and at running the risk of putting anyone on the spot, I was wondering if our friends from the city of Ottawa wanted to say a few words. In response, no pressure, but.
He's a consultant for the city of Ottawa.
Did you see me spring to defense? So my name is Ron as well, Ron. I am taking a leadership role in this study, and we are, of course, supporting all of the city staff. I would say, Sylvie, and I hope you know this, this assignment, the Byward Market Study, we were just starting, first of all. And the consultation that will be undertaken will probably blow away any consultation that we've seen on a civic city building project in our city. So it's just started. And I would make a pledge to you, Sylvie, I'll buy you dinner. Okay. You get to choose, because I love you. If at the end of that assignment, you say there's no vision. Okay? You can tell you've hit a part of my heart here. Okay? So this is our response. Thank you.
Okay. So we have a commitment that there's going to be a vision and lots of consultation. Great. Next question. We've got two more questions, and I think that's going to be it, because we'll have to close up.
I think when you consider public spaces like central courts or in South America, central plazas, wherever, it's always about where do people go? And some places, they're so popular, Place Jacques-Cartier in Montreal, and you ask yourself, why do people go there? It's sort of an ephemeral thing, but as Sylvie was mentioning, there's a lot of clutter in the bytown. But it doesn't matter what you do there, people are going to come and come and come. And when you're outside and like living in Chelsea, as I do, you say, well, let's go downtown. We go to the market because that's where things are happening. Spark Street, there have been many studies and many revisions and many efforts, and nothing happens. In my own view, is one, in the winter, forget it. It's a wind tunnel. It's very cold. And people don't live there, or if they do, we never see them wandering around. And as you were mentioning about grocery stores, and there's nothing neighborly about that, nothing. But I don't think you can just decide that Spark Street is going to be a mecca for people to come. You have to really understand that you've got a problem to overcome and identify those things first. Maybe it's residents, maybe it's whatever. But we have a long winter here. It's what you say about the fountains. Why don't we get some solar power and get them in the winter? But anyway, we have a long winter. And most of us experience the mall, the Spark Street Mall, as a very long, cold tunnel for many months. And I don't know whether you can have wind barriers or whatever, but I think we have to be real here. Can you make Spark Street Mall a place where people want to go?
Okay, thank you. It's an interesting question about the wind tunnels. And I'd be curious quickly, because we've still got one more question, whether anyone can talk to the idea of wind and sunlight and whatever in any of the projects that you've worked on or know about. So I don't know if anyone wants to touch that.
In terms of wind tunnels, there are different strategies that could be applied, and I agree it's very uncomfortable, and even more so in wintertime, but you could use, well, first of all, landscaping elements, kind of trees. There are no trees on Spark Street. We've asked the question, there are no trees. They kind of break, kind of the wind, even when they don't have any leaves. There are some canopy strategies that could be utilized also to help really kind of break the wind effect, but and it could all be simulated, so which is interesting. But I do agree, you have to identify the problem to make sure you respond well to that problem. So, I was looking for you. Mm-hmm. You have to identify the problem really well, as you're saying, to make sure you're going to be able. And the other thing you were saying, it's only one type of function right now. It's you only have a bit of retail in office spaces. So after working hours, it's not animated at all. So you don't necessarily want to go there. You're starting to build residential buildings. So I think it has to change with time. But identifying the problems and finding creative solution is really really important to that.
Cynthia, did you want to comment?
Well, there's the heat lamps and there's fans and there's ways of sort of extending the season and Adirondack chairs and blankets and places for people to sit out while they're having a meal. But, not every, just like I was showing earlier today, sort of this network of streets, like not every public space has to be as active and vibrant as the Byward Market all the time. I think that Spark Street will, I agree with Renee, evolve over time, but it's not quite there yet, so don't push it. Maybe focus on what you've got that's really active and make it better. So certainly the Byward Market plan is going to be really key to that, because you've got a lot going on already, and you it's a 6 and you want to make it a 10. And you can learn lessons from that. And we've also found that when places get, Yogi Berra says it's so crowded, no one goes there anymore. That places get so popular and busy that there's ways of sort of taking really successful elements and moving it somewhere else to seed activity. So maybe Spark Street becomes sort of a satellite for other things that become very popular, or that you want to kind of move around the city to animate and activate different places. So.
Okay, quickly.
Just want to say, Montreal, Place des Festivals was not really inhabited in wintertime. Then they started this event, which is called Montréal en Lumière. I don't know if you heard of that, which is a winter festival plus, you know, kind of culinary experience where, you know, kind of all. And suddenly, you know, everybody went out on the street. They're really kind of animating the public space. They have, you know, barrels with fire and so on, and all of these winter installations. And suddenly people started to come. And, you know, and it's a major, major event now in wintertime. They really transformed the constraint into a potential.
Are people living there above the...
Starting a bit further away.
Start out living in those buildings?
No, it's okay. Mostly office buildings. Yeah, but now there are some residential buildings which are starting to be built in that area.
You have the honor of the last question.
Thank you. And I think the question I have is about that comment about fun and weird. And Cynthia, you were showing pictures of some like citizen-created artwork. And how do you do that and maintain that while still having, you know, multiple levels of government and needing to license performers and like, how do you find that perfect balance? Do you have any secret sauce or?
Don't ask for permission. Just do it.
That's the wrong answer.
Well, don't break the. You don't have to break the law. You don't have to break the law, but you also can apologize afterwards. But if it and you know, every community has their thing, so I think you just have to do it.
Cynthia has worked with federal governments in the U.S. and different things, so I'm curious what if you have anything to add about working with different levels of government or whatever.
When you're working with government, you know, there's like thousands of people that work in that building that have skills and interests and things that they would like to do in the plaza and the public spaces outside of their building. So sort of capturing sort of that creativity of employees, for example, who know the rules and obey the rules, and it's their place of work, so they're not going to graffiti everything. So that's one thing, is letting people out of jail to sort of give them permission to populate and activate the public spaces in and around their own workplaces. And there's other ways of doing it. If you have like a BIA or a BRZ that an organization that can sort of own the umbrella liability. They get like a blanket permit for the year. They do this in Portland, Maine. They do this in New Orleans. You know, the Arts Council gets a blanket permit for the year and liability, and then they contract to other artists and performers and presenters so that they take the burden off of, you know, the puppeteer who doesn't need $3 million worth of liability insurance. So this is where the International Downtown Association and other organizations have figured out how to do it to remove the barriers to entry. But sometimes it's just a matter of saying yes and kind of getting out of the way within reason. So it's a trust issue, and it's understanding that the value added by creating an amazing event or providing people with the opportunity to express themselves has such power in terms of just word of mouth, generating excitement, changing the image of the city, that it's really worth whatever additional garbage you may have to pick up. But then you have your partners in the room that can help show up on that event or during that day to kind of help take the burden off the city. So. It's part of this evolving conversation that's happening in Ottawa about all of these issues to show that you are really getting to that tipping point of changing very old mindsets and looking around the world at how other people are doing it. And that's great.
Which is the purpose of, one of the purposes of the Urbanism Lab.
Yes. So as my wonderful friend Rick Hauser, who's mayor of Perry, New York, says, if you don't invest in Main Street, if you don't invest in your downtown, nobody else will. So if you don't fix the sidewalks and byway, no one else is going to do that. So if you want to attract people, you want to attract residents, you've got to basically invest in yourselves first, and then others will join in.
Okay. On that point, I'm going to end. I'd like to thank again all of our speakers. Donc, j'aimerais remercier tous nos présentateurs ce soir. Merci d'être venus, d'être déplacés. Thank you all for coming out tonight. Please note that our next Urbanism Lab is October 30th. It will be, the title is Gardens and the Healthy City. Donc, notre prochain labo, le 30 octobre, Jardins et Villes Saines. Je vous encourage de participer et de venir avec nous ou de participer par YouTube. Thank you all again for coming. We look forward to seeing you again for our fifth season. Thank you very much for all of your support. Merci. Bonsoir.